Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we shall discuss the topic mechanism of replication. How the process of replication takes place. First of all, you should know what is replication. When the DNA will make a copy of DNA, that is replication. And you know that in your body, the cells are dividing. And in the divisional process, in the S phase basically, DNA replication takes place. This you have done in class 11th. In the cell division, the different phases are there. G1, then S phase, then G2 phase, then M phase. If I talk about mitosis. So basically in the S phase of the cell cycle, the DNA replication takes place. Means the DNA will make a copy of itself, clear? And this is important so that the DNA can be transferred into the daughter cells. Now let us talk about how the process of replication takes place. If I talk about the structure of DNA, then you know that the DNA is double helix, right? It is like this. Your DNA is double helix. So firstly, what happened basically? The DNA replication takes place with the help of various enzymes. And one of the most important enzyme of the process of replication is DNA polymerase. It is DNA dependent polymerase. DNA dependent means it depends upon the DNA. Clear? Now actually why it has been given the term DNA polymerase? Polymerase means it will carry out the process of polymerization. If you do remember, we have discussed the structure of DNA and we have discussed that DNA, it is made up of nucleotides, right? So basically, what is this enzyme doing? It helps in the polymerization of deoxyribonucleotides, which results in the synthesis of new DNA molecule. Am I clear? So this is the main enzyme that is involved in the process of replication. It brings about the polymerization of deoxyribonucleotides. One more thing, this DNA, it works very fast. In addition to that, although it is working very fast, its polymerization, it is quite accurate. Okay, if I'll talk about the speed of this enzyme, now just let me give you the example of E. coli. E. coli is Escherichia coli. The total number of base pairs that are present in E. coli is 4.6 × 10⁶. These are the number of base pairs that are present in E. coli. Now in E. coli, basically DNA replication completes in 38 minutes. Clear? In E. coli, this number of base pairs, they got replicated. Means they became double in number in just 38 minutes. Now let me count this for a second. In 38 minutes, these number of nucleotides, these number of base pairs are again formed. Am I clear? 4.6 × 10⁶. So let me for 1 minute. 4.6 × 10⁶ divide by 38 minute. And let me find it for 1 second. 1 minute means 60 second, right? If I want to find it for 1 second, then I have to divide this by 60. If you solve this, you'll get 2000 base pair. Means just imagine in just 1 second, this DNA polymerase, it is making 2000 base pair. Now just imagine its speed. This I have given you the example of E. coli. In human being, or I can just talk about the eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, the speed is slow when you'll compare with this number. Otherwise, it is not that slow. But yes, it is less than 2000. Am I clear? So basically this polymerase, DNA polymerase, works very fast. Plus its replication is also precise. No doubt it is fast, but it is accurate. As you know, if there is a single change in the base pair, then the whole genotype of the organism can get changed. There could be mutation, and that could lead to various kind of abnormalities. We have discussed in chapter number 5, right? So this is accurate, clear? So DNA polymerase is the most common enzyme that is involved in the process of replication. Now let us talk about the process. As I was telling you, our DNA, it is in the form of a double helix like this. Clear? Now, as you know, in between the nitrogen base pairs are present. Suppose if I draw A here, then here will come T, and in between them there will be hydrogen bond. In the similar way, it will be there in the whole DNA. Now, if the DNA has to be replicated, then just use your common sense. First step should be the opening of the DNA double helix, means the two DNA strands, they should get separate. Am I clear? These two are joined, and how are they joined? With the help of nitrogen bond. As I told you, the nitrogen bases are present in between. Here also, suppose if G is here, then here will be C. If A is here, then here will be T, and in between them we are having hydrogen bond. So basically these hydrogen bond, they are maintaining the double helical structure. Now first step for the process of replication is just break this helical structure. Am I clear? Now just think, we have done that the length of our DNA is 2.2 meter. Now just think, this 2.2 meter long DNA, can it get opened at all the places? Its answer is no. Why? Because it would have required a lot of energy. That is not practically possible. So what happens actually, this DNA helix, it used to get opened at certain places. Suppose here it got opened like this. And how it will get opened? With the help of different enzymes. There is an enzyme helicase. It helps in breaking the hydrogen bond, which results in the opening of the helical structure. There is one more enzyme, topoisomerase. What this enzyme used to do? It used to break the tension. Just suppose the DNA is used to be a long string that is highly coiled. If you open from one end, then at the other end there will be a tension, right? So this topoisomerase, it is used to release the tension, and this helicase, it is used to break the hydrogen bond. So now as a result, just see what will happen. Here you can see the two DNA strands, they got a kind of separated. Am I clear? This is replication fork. I'll enhance this structure. I'm just telling you how it is happening in the 2.2 meter long DNA. Okay, DNA cannot get open totally. That is not possible. It requires lot of energy. So at particular places it will get open, and that particular places is known as replication fork. Clear? Suppose again these two enzymes will work here. Now again the hydrogen bond will get broken down. And like this, the two DNA strands, they got separated. Again here I got replication fork. Am I clear with this? Now let me enhance the replication fork. And one more thing, the process of replication, as you can see in this DNA, it is taking place at two places, right? So in the similar way, there are origin of replication in the DNA where the process of replication will take place. Means the replication fork will not become automatically at any place. No, there will be present origin of replication. If that is ORI. If here we are having origin of replication, only then these enzymes will come, they will act, the two strands will get separated, and then there will be formation of replication fork. And how the DNA will be synthesized, we shall study. And then this process will continue. Till here it will continue, and here again we are having the next origin of replication. Am I clear? In the similar way, in the 2.2 meter long DNA, at certain places we are having origin of replication. Now, one more thing we have done, actually you have done chapter number 12, that is biotechnology, its application, its process, in chapter number 11. There you have read about recombinant DNA technology. And if you do remember, in recombinant DNA technology, we have studied about the vectors, right? Why the vectors are used in the recombinant DNA technology? As they are having origin of replication. In recombinant DNA technology, we are making a new copy of DNA, a desired DNA, right? And in order to make a copy, there is requirement of origin of replication. As I told you now, origin of replication is a place where the process of replication would be initiated, and after that there will be a formation of the replication fork, and I told you the name of the enzymes. Now let us see in detail. Suppose here I am having the DNA. Suppose here I am having the DNA. Let two strands. Okay, I am not making it double helical now. I am simplifying it. So first of all, what will happen? There will be formation of replication fork. And like this, the replication fork, it would be formed at a few other places also. Suppose here is the replication fork. The two DNA strands, they got separated. The hydrogen bonds that were present here, they got broken down with the help of the helicase, and the tension was released with the help of the topoisomerase. Suppose here I am having the polarity 5-3 and here 3-5. And now basically what has to be happened, there must be synthesis of new DNA molecule. This is what replication is. From the DNA, a DNA is being made, right? Now, so now what happens basically, that I told you the most important enzyme, that is DNA polymerase. Now this DNA polymerase will come. And there is also present deoxyribonucleoside triphosphate. These are the molecules. Okay, this is an enzyme that will catalyze the reaction. These are the molecules that will be used as a substrate. Just think, if the DNA has to be synthesized, something must be used as a substrate. Now, so basically these deoxyribonucleoside triphosphate, they are working in two different ways, in the similar way. Firstly, they are being used as the substrate. How? We shall discuss the process. Secondly, they are used to give the energy. As you can see, it is deoxyribonucleoside triphosphate. Triphosphate, and you know that, like if I talk about the ATP, then you know that energy is stored in the bones. So here in the similar way, triphosphate is there. Energy is stored in between the bones. So these bones will get broken down. The triphosphate will convert into biphosphate or diphosphate, I can say, and then monophosphate, and then energy will be released. So this energy will be used for the replication, plus the broken down deoxyribonucleoside phosphate, monophosphate, that will be used as substrate. So it is being used in two different ways. Clear? Now, so now what will happen? The DNA polymerase enzyme, it will help in the synthesis of the strand. This is your parent strand, this is the newly synthesized strand. That is what we are doing. We are making DNA from the DNA. That is what replication is. Now, this DNA polymerase enzyme, it can work only from 5' to 3' direction. It can't work from this. It can't work from 3' to 5' direction. Is it fine? It can't work. It can work only in this direction from 5' end to the 3' end. Now just think. This is 5', this is 3'. This I am talking with respect to new strand. Mind it. Okay? So DNA polymerase can work only from 5' to 3' end. But here I am talking with respect to new strand. Now just suppose here 5' strand, 3', now. The newly synthesized strand, 3', then here will be 5', and there will be 3'. It can work from 5' to 3' end. It is 5', it is 3'. I am talking about with respect to new strand. This is the new DNA strand. Don't see the parental strand, because if you will see the parental strand, you will get confused, because it is from 3' to 5'. We are supposed to see the new strand, and you can see if here is the 3', obviously here would be the 5' end. You have learned the complementarity, right? So it can work, DNA polymerase can work easily in the 5' to 3' direction. So it DNA polymerase will come here, it will use deoxyribonucleoside, okay, monophosphate, and then it will catalyze the reaction like this from the 5' end to the 3', and there will be synthesis of a DNA strand. It would be continuous as there is no breakage. This is known as leading strand. Is it fine? But now here, if I talk about here, just see, here is 5' end, so now here would be 3' end. So now here the DNA polymerase is supposed to act like this, but it can't work from 3' end to 5' end. Am I clear? Here is the replication fork. The replication will start from the other end by the DNA polymerase. So here 5' end was there, it was comfortable in synthesizing the strand from 5' to 3'. But if I see here, here we are having 3' end, and DNA polymerase can't work like this. It can't work from 3' end to the 5' end. It will not work like this. Am I clear? If I talk about the new strand, here it is 5', so here it is 3', and here it is 5'. I'm talking about the new strand. It can't work like this. If it would have worked like this, then the strand formed would be continuous. As per the nature, it will work from 5' to 3'. So it will work from here. It is not working from here, it is working from here. So it is working from 5' to 3'. But in this manner, the strand produced, it is not continuous. Earlier the strand was straight, but now you can see the strand is formed in the form of fragments. Am I clear? So that's why this strand is known as lagging strand. Lagging, you understand, which is lagging behind. This is the leading strand and that is the lagging strand. Clear? You can see in the lagging strand we are having the fragments. Each fragment is known as Okazaki fragment. Each fragment is known as Okazaki fragment. And obviously after the replication is complete, these fragments, they are joined, and again there is a need of an enzyme, and that enzyme is ligase, DNA ligase. After the completion of the replication, these Okazaki fragments, they will get joined with the help of an enzyme, that is DNA ligase. Is it fine? So this is a replication of the DNA. From one DNA we got two DNA. Firstly, there is breaking of the hydrogen bonds. The two template, the two parental strands of the DNA, they got separated. And then with the help of the DNA polymerase, there is synthesis of the new strand. At one end, the DNA strand is being made continuously, as DNA polymerase can work in 5' to 3' direction, and that strand is leading strand. and at the other end we are having lagging strand which is having the Okazaki fragments, and the Okazaki fragments they are then joined with the help of the DNA ligase. This is DNA replication. Now just think, suppose here I am having a cell and this cell is undergoing mitosis. Suppose this cell is undergoing mitosis. Now what will happen? This cell will undergo G1 phase, then S phase, then G2 phase, and then M phase, and then there will be cell division. Now in S phase, I told you the DNA will get replicate. The DNA will make a copy of itself. So suppose at the S phase, the DNA has been doubled. But now after that, there will be obviously G2, then M phase, and then in M phase, due to any reason, the cell division hasn't occur. Means now this, actually what was supposed to happen, suppose the DNA has been doubled, now in the M phase there must be cell division, so that half DNA must be distributed to each daughter cell and they will be having the same DNA that is being present in the parent. Now if suppose due to some reason there is the cell division is not taking place, now what will happen? The newly formed daughter cell, it will be having genetic abnormality in any sense. Okay, the genetic abnormalities we have discussed in chapter number 5. If the DNA has replicated, the DNA has doubled. Now it is supposed to be distributed to each daughter cell, but by somehow the cell division hasn't occurred. So there is no formation of the two daughter cells. Rather, one daughter cell is having the double DNA. So this can lead to various kind of chromosomal abnormalities. Clear? Thank you.